The long answer is, well, I had to find a driver for the network device, which was not included in Debian. Had to fix some bugs in this driver, and had to ask some mailing list because I was not able to fix this problem on my own. This took me about one day, and further the not supported 3D graphics of the ATI device was another task for 2 days to get the 3D acceleration working, and so it was not real fun. And so I can understand if some people aren't really happy about it, maybe. But we cannot do much about it. So we cannot force ATI to release their code or whatever, but it's just the fact that there are some users out there who are not really happy with Debian. These users might also be multimedia enthusiasts. Well, there is not enough support currently, but we have no real chance to help them. These are just poor users who probably will not use Debian, and which is not really our fault, but we could at least try some to give them some hints and some documentation what they could do if they really want to do to try Debian. The lucky user's view is, well, he was lucky enough to obtain some supported hardware. The installer went fine, and he finally reached the task selection of well, some 10 items or so to select from, and most users who are not really comfortably are wondering what to do now. Well, I want to do some desktop, or what desktop is it? And in my opinion, this task selection, well, is not really as user friendly as it would be. It works for many people who are familiar and they know they can use Aptitude or Synaptic or whatever to continue from this step on, but I'm a little bit missing the kind of leading hand for our users to make the system just nice, just as I want it to be. A different point of view is the upstream developer. The upstream developers, so those people who are developing the software we are including into Debian, are not necessarily Debian users. They might be Debian users, but in one way, I think they are also Debian users, even if they are keen on some other distribution, because they have other users of their software that are working with Debian, and so they use Debian as kind of quality assurance for their software. A Debian developer, for instance, noticed that there is no manual page or whatever for the software. Most Debian developers are writing man pages. Those who do not should do it and forward this as patch to the upstream developer, and thus the upstream developer has some profit from those Debian users. And as well, Debian is porting upstream software to other architectures, and very often there are some problems detected by these porting teams, and if these problems are reported to upstream, these people also profit from Debian. And in this very abstract view, they are also users of Debian. Well, the Debian developers view, as I think it's a kind of a missing link between upstream and the end user, because we are in between the software, which is anywhere at the tower, and the machine of the user that installs and uses the software. And if we are doing a good job, our users will be happy, and also the upstream developer, the upstream developer is also happy in the sense I tried to describe before. Well, there is some principle of free software. You stay just independent from commercial interests of a producer. I mean, if I would be an employee of Red Hat, SUSE, or whatever, I wouldn't have really the freedom to pick whatever upstream software I would like to integrate. I would have to follow some, I have to care for those software which makes a big market share and try to make the distribution which my employer is promoting become a wide user base. Wide user base you can get easily if you stay in a large market and not so much in niche products. If you think about Debian Edu, which is caring for schools, the schools are not really known for paying much money for software. So the main distributors will not really care about schools, or in my case with this Debian Med stuff, these people will not care about medical stuff because there is not so much software to bring to the medics. And so in Debian I have the freedom to say, well, my idea is I want to support this special field of software and bring it to the user, and I have the freedom to do so because nobody would say, well, do something more useful. In one hand, we are some kind of hunters and collectors of free software, because if there's a piece of free software, any Debian developer thinks, oh, this is a nice thing, let's package it and integrate it. But in principle, we should rather be more or less designer of a comprehensive system and not just cherry picking anywhere. And my point of view is try to make some consistent system which really helps the users instead of just packing random software. Then finally we have the derivers view. They say, well, Debian is really nice, but it does not really fit my needs. I would like to change this or that to make something else. And they just use Debian as a nice point to start from, and then take the freedom to make some other system, which is fine, the license allows this, but I think it's not always the clever approach to go. So, what means universal? I tried some search on WordNet dictionary, and well, it means comprehensive, general, and also adaptable. I think these points are quite valid for Debian as it is, and it is really adaptable because we can adapt Debian for several things, and the developers are doing it, but they're doing something else. So another try has also three meanings if you are asking for the adjective. And here is one point I stressed a little bit with red color. It is adapted to various purposes, sizes, form, and operations. So if you have, for instance, a screwdriver, which is adapted to, well, you can mount any screw, and or you have a tool which can be used for many different things. So in this sense, I have a little bit problems with Debian because it is not really adapted to anything. It is adaptable, but not yet adapted to certain means. Special cases, for instance, the Debian Edu custom Debian distribution, it is really adapted to the use inside tools. It can, for instance, handle students' accounts. It enables students to run educational software, games, whatever, and it does it in a really good way, and it is also a good tool to teach students basic skills in informatics science, and so on. And it's so, Debian Edu is adapted from a teacher's point of view. Adaptation is about a viewpoint on the thing you want to use. But if you are, for instance, a scientist, you find in Debian very interesting applications. They are included. There are many outside, but well, it is quite interesting. And if you have no mic, please be quiet over there. Thank you. Debian has a high potential to be a full-featured scientific workbench, but it is kind of served in pieces. If you are if you're going to a low-budget market and buy a workbench, you have to assemble it yourself. And this is more or less what we are currently providing. It would be really good if we could high-quality tool provider who brings the workbench to the customer and put it in their workroom to be ready for us. So we have no real concept to guide scientific users. And so it is just only adaptable from the scientist point of view. And well, it is slightly better for biologists, because in Debian 8 we care for these biologists, but there could be done some more for other sciences and also other fields of. Well, we have this Debian multimedia project, which is not really active inside Debian. We have this Debian Lex, which could be do something for lawyers and so forth, but these projects are not really alive. And so I think we could cover those special things much better if somebody would agree with me and start some work with this. So what about the development inside Debian? Do we scale well in every direction? Debian is kind of a multi-dimensional room where we have an increasing number of people involved, which means not only the Debian developers, we have many people who are providing work to Debian as translators and bug reporters who send patches, and so the number of people who are working on Debian is increasing, and the number of packages is increasing from release to release. The number of architects is not so drastically increasing. We got some more, we even lost some, but the tendency is also an increase. Well, the number of bugs also increases. The number of bugs who are closed is not so high as those who are opened. We have an increasing number of users. We also have an increasing number of derivatives. And last but not least, we have an increasing number of frameworks, which is not really nice, but these are some points we are, well, increasing numbers mean there is some change. If you move forward into quantity, at some point in time you just gain a new quality, which is not very new. And the problem is to find the right moment in time when this critical point is changed, is reached, where the quantity makes a new approach into new quality. And well, it is hard to find out this point. I think we just step over this point. Debian just reached the new quality than we had in maybe 2000, and we go into some process of evolution to move to something different. I think it's a positive move. Like, well, if not, we would not be here, we would not be on the Debian conference and would produce new things. But we have to be aware that we cannot approach as we did before. We have to find some new methods to work on Debian. And so I think that custom Debian distributions are ideal to deal with nearly all these dimensions of growth I mentioned before. Well, some quote from 2003, I hope this year number is fine compared to my talk number, is when Manoj Srivastava said, for the most part, Debian is a bazaar of cathedrals with a few producers in place to override the low-level cathedral in exceptional situations. Each developer has, within reason, full control over his packages, modulo following Debian technical policy, thus creating the low-level cathedral. The technical committee and the general resolution protocol offers means of overriding developer decisions about their own packages. This means, more or less, we have kind of a flat structure with some controlling mechanisms. And the structure means we have a one-to-one relation between maintainer and package. This has just changed because we have some group maintenance for several complicated packages. So we have a end maintainer to one package relation. Whereby one package means if you have X packages, the result are several binary packages, but there are many people are caring for the X packages, which leads to some reliable teamwork. And this work on the phase two means we stay on a technical level. But I think we will evolve further on, where in custom Debian distributions, we have an end-to-end maintainer to package relation. That means several maintainers care for a set of packages which build some kind of closed subset inside Debian. And so we have some complete suites covering use cases. And we have users, and all users have his own use case. So we have to find out which users are keen on using Debian in their special field. By the way, did anybody solve the puzzle? Hands up if anybody solved it. So, why do I think that Debian scales better? We have the increasing number of people. So, if we try to apply some substructure in Debian, the overall number is the same, but if you have smaller projects, people are working on, who are focusing on a certain field, we have some better focus on these packages in these fields. If we are subgrouping the number of packages, we have closed package sets, and these subsets are easier to maintain in the overview. And so the number of packages problem, which is growing continuously, might be solved. Well, the number of bugs will increase more or less. We cannot do much about it. But if you have a number of maintainers who try to care for a number of packages, at least I hope that they will try to have more motivation to fix those bugs who are relevant for their custom Debian distributions. Also, the number of users, which is increasing in general, is reduced to some specialists, for the Debian Edu case, the teachers. And so the maintainers try to cope for the specialist issues, so they try to talk to teachers and ask what they can do for them. Also, the number of derivatives is growing, as I said, but if we do some reasonable customization, we could perhaps offer some means that derivers might say, oh, well, there's no real need to derive because everything is inside Debian, and I prefer to join Debian and work inside Debian than just deriving and start from scratch all the time. Well, one thing I did not mention in my list of items is the time span in between the releases, because this was, for the last release, not increasing. We became better. This is really good. This idea that we could release the time span, could decrease the time span between releases, this custom distribution was born because it might be possible to release subsets of Debian as custom Debian distribution. For instance, if you think of schools, they have a certain frequency to upgrade, maybe the school year. So it makes sense to have such fixed releases for certain subsets. There are no techniques to do this currently. That's just the idea, but maybe it might work in the future. So what about these derivatives? Debian has, according to probably some old numbers, 129 derivatives. Fedora has 630, and all others has less than 30. Not Fedora, but 63, sorry. And, well, the question is, it is a good sign or a bad sign? Who thinks Debian, this many distributions are a good sign? Other people think it's a bad sign? It is good if you see large numbers, and well, I think it is a good sign that people regard Debian as a high quality distribution, which, well, makes sense to use and derive from. But on the other hand, these 129 people think Debian is not good enough for my use case. And so, well, there is a pro and con in these numbers. And in this talk, I would like to stress the not so good side, because if something is good, we don't have to change it. It's fine. If people like us, it is fine. But
I know the puzzle is. The puzzle is needle in the haystack.
Yeah, the puzzle is needle in the haystack.
What do I mean?
You're great. One free beer. Yeah. And so, well, I would like to express some ideas how we can make those people who derive from Debian even more happy than they are currently. Well, what kind of derivers do we have? There is some kind of a poor, diligent deriver. He has some misconception about Debian. He thinks Debian is just one way. He takes Debian as a ready product, which can be changed in any way. So it is a view of the, well, the user of some property or software who has to accept what his provider of software hands him over, and then, well, but Debian is something else. You can work on Debian, and you can tell us what's not so nice in Debian, what would you like to change. And then this poor, diligent deriver has perhaps some problems with human beings. He is sending a patch, please change this or that. And the maintainer says, go away with your stupid patch, I have no interest in it. This is not nice, but well, we are human beings. And please try again, and perhaps the maintainer just changed his mind. The problem for the diligent deriver is that he has continues to work to keep up with the development of Debian. And so, well, I have observed several derivatives of Debian, or the most famous derivative is Knoppix, which has 50 derivatives of its own. Those projects tend to die at any point in time, because the deriver has not enough time to keep up with the speed of Debian development. So my hint is, rather try to cooperate than to make something else. Then there is the impatient, desperate deriver. He knows that Debian is something you can work on, something you can influence, but he faces certain showstoppers in Debian. Well, not every maintainer is as responsive as he would like to be. And if the deriver has a timeline, he has no choice to change Debian in the way he wants to be. He has to derive. And, well, he knows the principle of duocracy, that those who do something are those who decide what is really done. And so he just takes Debian and does what he wants to do. But here I have also a hint to leave open the way back to Debian, because if the showstopper is solved and if it's possible to reintegrate your stuff, just try it. Then we have some authority employed derivatives. I named here some from Munich and Vienna, the Extremadura, and some other Spanish derivatives. Those people are gathered by the government to do something else. And maybe it's a known fact that every authority thinks it is very special and cannot do the same as some other authority, so they need their own stuff. So this derivative is more forced by social reasons to derive from Debian. An alternative would be to continue the Debian EGAF custom Debian distribution, where it is much a sketch what could be done in a diploma work, and there is not really much substance behind it. A similar situation is our funded project, the DMUDI project, the Debian Multimedia Distribution, was founded by the EU, and the EU wanted to have a product, and Debian is not their product, so it had been something else. Then we have the Lucky LiveCD connector. LiveCDs are really cool. You can demonstrate something on a booth and show off your nice program, the product, and you can test your hardware, boot your favorite OS on random computers. Live DVD from Klaus Knopfwater saved my life when I was sitting in the middle of Iceland and had to find an internet cafe to fix something at home. And you have very good usage of live CDs in kiosk systems. And if you perhaps want to give a Linux course in a computer lab, you are quite fine with live CD. The problem? You have to keep your system up to date, and this is really a problem. I've heard there's even a book of 200 or 300 pages, how to remaster Knoppix. It's really nice to remaster Knoppix. If you have done it once, you don't want to do it again, because it's over and over the same work, and doing the same work over and over is not really fun for people like us. So just use LiveHelper. I've heard about LiveHelper here in this conference, and it's really great, and it just moves what you want to. If this a list of packages you want to have on your live CD and some configuration you want to have, and tip, you enter some line and say, well, make my live CD, and you are ready. So perhaps you can join this effort regarding this two Oculus C principle and make the Live Helper even better to fit our needs, and so all lucky Live CD creators could use plain Debian stuff. Then we have the clever commercial developer. Those people want to turn Debian into a sellable product. Debian is not sold, anybody can use it for free, but there are many companies who base their work on Debian. And know the names, it is no hidden secret. And these people, well, they add some value to Debian. And for instance, this might be non-free drivers to help those poor users I mentioned in the very beginning, or print some manuals, or they can also sell some service for enterprises, what we cannot really do inside Debian, because we are just volunteers. And so it is basically about rebranding Debian and add some value. I think Debian supports those derivers, or should it even more support to make their work as easy as possible? But they should be aware that Debian even competes with those derivers, so if they are not good enough, users will use Debian instead of their stuff. In general, I think the derivers should one lesson learn, the the difference between Debian and the derivative should be very small, smaller than some epsilon, and over all time. So if you derive more and more from Debian, I think the success is not as much as it could be. So keep the diff always small. And remind, we are on your side. Talk to us if we can help you. It's fine, we would like to. So finally, I would like to say something about special applications inside Debian. Well, we have to be aware that Debian becomes larger and larger. So the question arises, how many packages are good for Debian? And I don't know. I don't really know. But I think if we bring some special applications under quality control, we are able to attract a wider user base, and this can't be really bad. And so I think if there's a maintainer who cares for his package, or a group of maintainers who cares for their packages, it can't be really bad if we have more and more packages. If there are packages who are not maintained, we can get rid of them, because they probably have also not a large user base. So how many packages are good for our users is a real question. And I think if we include special applications, only if there's a small user base, this is really nice for our users, and we can spread into areas which are not covered by other distributors. Finally, the question is, what about large user data? We yesterday heard a talk about Zanger, and with the genome project, they have really, really huge data. And so it makes no sense to put them on every Debian in the world. But it would be interesting to have a solution for those people to perhaps have a data area inside Debian. There's a long-standing open bug number 38902, which is just tagged won't fix without any comment, which is not really nice, because I think we should do something about those people who need large chunks of data. So what is the basic goal of the custom Debian distributions? We have more than 15,000 packages, and our users are not interested in all of them. They are interested in a subsets, and we have some groups of specialized users who are need a very easy installation and configuration of these subsets of packages. So while Debian stays a general distribution, and this is the main point, this will not change, it should support specialists as well, to make Debian really the universal system. Only if we are able to support every user who wants Debian support, it will work for everybody. So we try not to do a derivative from Debian. And the basic idea is, do not make a separate distribution, but make Debian fit for special purposes instead. But for the future, I think custom Debian distribution could solve structural problems inside Debian. And I have to say, well, I do not really like this name, custom Debian distribution, because most people who hear this name think this is something else than Debian. So if somebody has a better name for this, I am open for discussion. It should maybe fit for user interests, and in my opinion, it makes Debian stronger if done in the right way. What is the right way? I hope I can elaborate next year more about some common techniques which should be shared, which my first attempt did not really work, but I hope I hope that I learned some lessons and make it better for next year. And so the future of Debian was also known as the last final step towards total world domination. I think I totally agree with Thorsten, who had to talk about this before me. It was nice, I wasn't able to join. And so, yeah, you are right, it's a needle in a haystack, and I think the custom distribution are kind of needed in a high stack for our users, for those users who are seeking for needles inside Debian. I want to show them immediately and not just by grabbing all the huge high stack of packages. Just show them what they really need and make them happy to become a wider user base. So now it's open for discussion, and I hope for you like this idea.
Okay, so firstly I should disclose that I'm employed indirectly by Mark Shuttleworth. But I don't think that affects what I'm about to say. So I agree that CDDs are a good thing and they should be encouraged and so forth. But it's very important to realize that I think there's nothing wrong if somebody chooses to derive from Debian. This is what free software is. Free software is software that everybody is allowed to modify and that everybody can modify. And when people choose to exercise that freedom, they have a lot of reasons, which may or may not be something that is maybe wrong with Debian, and if that's the case, then obviously we should improve that. But sometimes they have their own reasons, maybe they disagree with us about something, and it's definitely unreasonable if we say that people should not, you know, if we say that somehow we disapprove or that these people are doing something wrong. In fact, the biggest problem that we have at the moment with derivatives is that it's fantastically difficult to do a derivative, and you really need to put in an awful lot of effort, and you can't keep it up to date properly because our source code management tools are so poor. And I would really like to see some improvement in this area. This was in the Wacky Ideas blog earlier, and if anybody has any comments, ideas, please talk to me about it. Really, there's nothing wrong. We say, I want more people to take Debian. I want them to easily be able to derive it. I want some random person in their house to be able to make a derived distribution for their friends and to still have reasonable security support and for it to all work properly. And we're a long way from that, unfortunately.
I have a simple question. Maybe I don't understand the difference or the boundary between deriving a distribution and customizing a distribution. Yeah. Because for me, it's really interesting to customize a distribution.
I should have mentioned it. We have a certain term, custom Debian distribution. It is a name for customization inside Debian. This name is badly chosen because it's misleading.
Can I explain, because you've actually failed to mention, that CDDs do not have different versions of the packages that are already in Debian. So a CDD consists of some additional packages in Debian, and some extra attention is paid to certain packages that they're interested in, but all the time it's the same versions as are in Debian proper.
That's customization.
That's what
yes.
CDD
okay.
means. And derived distributions are ones where there is a different source code, different binaries for at least some of the packages.
This is what's called formerly Debian internal projects. And we wanted to make some separation between technical projects and this user customization. But we succeeded completely in confusing people who are just wanted to derive Debian and think custom Debian distribution is something they want. So we have this term found, and if we find a better name which is not so confusing, I would be really lucky, but I think we have to explain it anyway. So if you have a Debian DVD or a stack of Debian CDs, we have everything which custom Debian distributions provide. It's all completely inside Debian. This is what this term means.
I'm from the city of Mini, and actually what the main problem I think is that we cannot cope really with the development in Debian. So we have to take the stable distribution, and there is no development for stable. And that's actually good for us, because we have this can say, okay, we have problems with this kind of hardware because it's new, and we just exchange, for example, the XOR E810 driver from new hardware. And that's just one change to one package. But we would not be able to say, okay, look all the time at Debian unstable, get all the new stuff inside. We are basically two or three people who do the main development, and it's impossible for us to run with the unstable development. And the city has to work, so
yeah, sure.
We cannot. Yeah, we have a release cycle inside too. We have change processes and incident processes, which make a new release every 3 months, something like that. And we just take stable and add some new features for us. But yeah,
well,
I don't see. As long as there is not something like development of stable, there won't be. Many people who really stay in Debian.
Well, I'm in real favor of keeping stable for such purpose. Yes. And I think you should at least try to make sure that the next stable distribution contains everything you really need. If you reach this for this particular moment, and then there's also this backports effort, which at least I've heard about it. This is quite good. And supports the main features of new versions which are not stable, but you can perfectly use it. It's also signed by Debian developers, and so perhaps this backports effort is something you could at least get some help from.
We're using some of the packages from backports, but most of the time we're just staying stable and we don't want to change all the system every 3 months. I'm not sure how fast the development is currently unstable, but I would say maybe the whole distribution is new every 3 months or half a year. Every package has changed, and that's impossible to test.
Yeah, but what I think about is try to. Well, I think you did some local adaptations, which is besides this keeping up with current development, and this adaptations and customizations. If you bring this inside Debian for a certain purpose, other people can just learn from it. Because I think, well, Munich is not Vienna, but if they share some code between their stuff, they could have some common profit. So.
Yeah, sure, but that would be for stable, not for
our stable. Yeah, but
there's no infrastructure to really develop for stable in Debian now.
Yeah, sure, but once we will release Lenny, at least I hope so. And
yeah.
If there is some common code in Lenny, you can have a common profit.
Currently, we are starting, and
sure.
We might be at the end of year.
Yeah, well, sure.
Yeah.
I completely agree. Yeah.
Maybe there's a way to really do some development for the stable too, in some extra repository or something like that, where people can share their stuff.
There are perfectly valid reasons to work the RAFs. This is a perfectly valid reason, but try to keep the diff small.
Yeah, we try to.
My name is Petter Reynoldsen, and I'm one of the DBMU developers. We have, I think we were actually starting these derived things in Debian 6 years ago. And we have always focused on making as few modifications as possible, as much configuration as we need, and making sure that the Debian packages in the table include our fixes, so we don't have to modify them the next release. And this has worked pretty well. We started out with approximately 40 special packages, and at the moment I think we are down to 8. Hopefully for Lenny we should go down to 0, but it's a long and slow process to convince all developers in. For the maintainers of the packages, we need to do the modifications we need for Debian EU. It's as simple as how do you automatically configure other servers during install time. A lot of maintainers in Debian do not really understand the problem. They just say, well, you just fire up your Emacs and edit it. But that doesn't really solve our problem. And we also want to make sure that our changes to configuration files are kept during upgrades to avoid upgrade troubles. That doesn't really work very well at the moment. We often give the sysadmin the choice between a configuration file that used to work with the old version and a new configuration file that doesn't really do what they want. And those two options are not great when you do upgrades. So I really wish that the Debian maintainer would keep this in mind and fix their packages to handle the upgrades more gracefully when you have downloaded the modifications. But my point is that, yes, we cannot modify the stable distribution that much. Well, actually, there is the edge and a half effort. performance, hopefully it will be a process to get the new kernel and new X server. But my point is that even if you can modify the stable distribution, you can get your fixed signal unstable. And then you wait for 2 years, and then you actually have modified stable for the next release.
I'm Johnny Stoll from Indonesia. I have a question. What is being done to encourage people that are making these derivative distributions to give back their improvements to the Debian project?
I can say exactly, holding talk on DevConf. Holding a talk on a DevConf. Well, I try to explain how to give back something. We cannot, we have no handle to tell those people just backport your stuff. I can only say, well, we are open, try to give something back, but.
Yeah. Seems like they should realize there's a moral obligation to do so.
Yeah, but. What should I do if somebody just goes and drives Debian, but how should I have no communication channel to this person?
I mean,
he's free to do so, and it's fine to do so, and, but if he don't ask me to do something for him, I...
Is there any kind of license that would require them to give back?
No, there isn't.
That would be a non-free license.
Yeah, exactly. There shouldn't be such a license.
So Debian does exactly this to upstreams. You might as well ask the same question. You know, what do upstreams do to try to get us to tell them about the changes that we make? And the answer is, most upstreams do nothing at all, and it is up to us to go and tell those upstreams, you know, here are these changes, please take them. And, well, some Debian developers do this very well, and other Debian developers do it less well. And I think it's very much the same with derivatives.
Okay.
One interesting observation is that it is the derivative's advantage to actually push the changes back in. I think that's the mechanism that makes this work, because if they are deriving too much, the maintenance load will be too high and they will just not be able to keep up. That's why a lot of Debian developers are pushing changes back into upstream, and that's why Skog Linux Debian EDU is pushing our stuff back into Debian. We don't really want to have that high maintenance load. But other than that, I don't think we want any harder enforcement mechanism, because that would make software not free.
But the point is here, Debian competes with those derivatives. So if they want to be as good as their competitor, they should provide something back. Maybe. I don't know if this is the answer.
I think actually that's kind of the opposite of the answer. Some of the derivatives feel that if they send their patches back, that they will be,
okay,
you know, helping their competitors more than they're helping them themselves.
Yeah,
I think that they are mistaken. And well, evidence seems to suggest that the people who don't do that don't always last very long. So
I think you have the option of standing on someone's shoulders or their toes, and I know what I would choose.
Probably my answer was biased by the Debian point of view. Okay, how many minutes left?
Four.
You will find me for the next 2 days here, DevConf, if there are any questions.